So as always, I say Shabbat Shalom, and we're going to start off with Colossians 3:17. Giving all praise and glory to the Most High power of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, whatever you say, whatever you do in action, do all by Hashem Mashiach Yahweh Shai. Giving thanks to the Most High and the Father by Hashem Mashiach Yahweh Shai. So everything that we say and do is going to be in the name of the anointed Savior, going to the throne of the Most High, because he said, only no man come to the Father but by me. He said, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it, that the Father could be glorified in the Son. And we give thanks to the Most High, as it tells in Ephesians 5:20. It says, giving thanks always for all things unto the Most High and the Father in the name of our power, Mashiach Yahweh Shai. So by Hashem, Mashiach Yahweh Shai. So it's all validated with scripture and whatever, at least the Spirit brings me to bring forth to the congregation of Israel. It has to be backed up with scripture. So it's not just something that is made up. It's validated with the scriptures. That was St. John 14:6 and St. John 13 that I quoted. So let's go to Genesis, the 47th chapter, and we're going to start on verse 28. Genesis 47:28. And Jacob lived in the land of Egypt 17 years. So the whole age of Jacob was 147 years. So wow. Jacob, when he came to Egypt, you know, we know that, we went over this last week with Joseph, his son, who was wicked brothers, told their daddy that Joseph was dead. You know, he thought he was dead all that time. So when he came to Egypt behind the famine, and Joseph was set up right under the Pharaoh. It's telling you here that our forefather Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, lived in the land of Egypt 17 years. So the whole age of Jacob was 147 years. So he lived 147 years. Verse 29. And the time drew nigh, which is near, that Israel must die. Now it says Israel, Jacob's name was changed to Israel. So it's still talking about this, our forefather Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. And the time drew near, or nigh, that Israel must die. And he called his son Joseph, and said unto him, if now I have found grace in thy sight, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and deal kindly and truly with me. Bury me not, I pray thee, in Egypt. So he wanted to be buried in the land of Egypt. He said, bury me not, I pray you, in the land of Egypt. But I will lie with my fathers. See, he will lie with his fathers, his forefathers. And thou shalt carry me out of Egypt and bury me in their burying place. And he said, I will do as thou hast said. So he said, hey, don't bury me in this land of Ham. Bury me in the place where my forefathers were. And he said, swear unto me. And he swore unto him. And Israel bowed himself upon the bed's head. Genesis 48:1. It came to pass after these things that one told Joseph, behold, thy father is sick. And he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. So Joseph had two sons in the land of Ham, which is so-called Africa today, by the name of Manasseh, who was the firstborn, and Ephraim, who was the second son, born in the land of Ham. And one told Jacob and said, behold, thy son Joseph cometh unto thee, and Israel strengthened himself and sat upon the bed. So he said, hey, somebody told him that Joseph's coming to him, so he strengthened himself and sat up on the bed. And Jacob said unto Joseph, the Most High Almighty, the power Almighty appeared unto me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me and said unto me, behold, I will make thee fruitful and multiply thee, and I will make of thee a multitude of people, and will give this land to thy seed after thee for an everlasting possession. So he telling him that he's going to make him have, allow him to have a lot of children. And now thy two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, which were born unto thee in the land of Egypt, before I came unto thee into Egypt, are mine. See, the father claims the sons because they come from his lineage. That's his inheritance, his seed, his lineage. And now thy two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, which were born unto thee in the land of Egypt, behold, before I came unto thee into Egypt, are mine, as Reuben and Simeon, they shall be mine. And thy issue, which thou begettest after them, shall be thine, and shall be called after the name of their brethren in their inheritance. As for me, when I came from Padan, Rachel died by me in the land of Canaan in the way, when yet there was but a little way to come unto Ephrah. And I buried her there in the way of Ephrah, the same as Bethlehem. So he's telling Joseph that his mother, Rachel, died before they can get to Ephrah. And Israel beheld Joseph's sons and said, who are these? He looked at them and said, who are these? And Joseph said unto his father, they are my sons, whom the Most High have given me in this place. And he said, bring them, I pray thee, unto me, and I will bless them. Now the eyes of Israel were dim for age. He's 147 years old. So that he could not see. And he brought them near unto him. Joseph brought his two sons near unto him. And he kissed them and embraced them. And Israel said unto Joseph, I had not thought to see thy face. And lo, the Most High have shown me also thy seed. Not only you, but the Most High have showed me my grandsons, my two grandsons. And Joseph brought them out from between his knees, and he bowed himself with his face to the earth. And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near unto him. So he brought his two sons near him. Ephraim was on Joseph's right hand, and Manasseh was on his left hand, Israel is facing him, so that would be Israel's left hand and right hand. Ephraim on the Israel left hand, and Manasseh on Israel's right hand, as they're facing each other. And Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it upon Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head. So he did like this, crossed his hand, like put his right hand on Ephraim's head and his left hand on Manasseh. Mind you, Manasseh's the older son and Ephraim is the younger son. And verse 14, and Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it upon Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head, guiding his hands wittingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. And he blessed Joseph and said, the Most High before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac did walk, the power which fed me all my life long unto this day, the angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads, and let my name be named on them, and the name of my fathers, Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. This is how he's blessing them. And when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. And he held up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head unto Manasseh's head. So remember, Israel have his right hand on Ephraim and his left hand on Manasseh. Now, Manasseh, the firstborn, was supposed to get the inheritance, but it switched up. So Joseph took Israel's right hand off of Ephraim, put it on Manasseh. And he's doing it like this. Verse 18, and Joseph said unto his father, not so, my father, for this is the firstborn. Put thy right hand upon his head. And his father refused and said, I know it, my son. Say, I know what I'm doing. I know it, my son. I know that Manasseh is the firstborn. He said, I know it, my son. I know it. He also shall become a people. And he also shall be great. But truly his younger brother shall be greater than he. And his seed shall become a multitude of nations. And he blessed them that day, saying, in thee shall Israel bless, saying, the Most High make thee as Ephraim and as Manasseh. And he set Ephraim before Manasseh. And Israel said unto Joseph, behold, I die, but the Most High shall be with you and bring you again unto the land of your fathers. Moreover, I have given to thee one portion above thy brethren, which I took out of the hand of the Amorite with my sword and with my bow. So he said he gave him a portion above his brethren that he took from the Amorites, which would be northern Israel, where they lived at. Genesis 49 and 1. And Jacob called unto his sons and said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. Gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob. And hearken unto Israel your father. Reuben, thou art my firstborn. Reuben was the firstborn. He said, my might. And the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity and the excellency of power. Just a moment. So, Reuben representing the Seminole Indians. You know, what it says, the beginning of his strength, because he was the firstborn, the excellency of dignity because it's sharp. The Reubenites, if you notice, like a lot of them were located around Florida, they dressed. They were sharp dressers, you know, and they wore the turbans and the robes and the jewelry. Verse 4. It says, unstable as water, thou shalt not excel. Because remember, the firstborn is supposed to got the inheritance. Supposed to have been over all the other tribes. But see, it says, unstable as water, rules unstable. Thou shalt not excel, because thou went up to thy father's bed. then defileth thou it. He went up to my couch. Reuben had sex with Jacob's wife. Let's go to Genesis 35 and 22. Genesis 35 and 22. Genesis 35, 22. And it came to pass when Israel dwelt in that land that Reuben went and lay with Bilhah, his father's concubine. And Israel heard it. Now the sons of Jacob were 12. See? So Reuben laid with Bilhah, his father's concubine. That's what he's saying. He's unstable in his way. He went. When it says, because thou went up to thy father's bed, that's what he did. And see, Deuteronomy 27 and 20. Deuteronomy 27 and 20. Cursed be he that lieth with his father's wife. Because he uncovered his father's skirt, and all the people shall say. So it's a curse to sleep with your father's wife or concubine, as we see here. That's a curse. So, and see, when he say he will not excel, I mean, he will not be the head tribe. He's not going to be the head tribe, as he should have been, as being the firstborn. Verse 5. Simeon and Levi are brethren. Instruments of cruelty are in their habitations. So, you know, Simeon and Levi, they dwell right together. When you look at the Haitians and Dominicans, they dwell right together, right next to each other. Dominican Republic and Haiti. It says, verse 6, O my soul, come not thou into their secret, unto their assembly. Mine honor, be not thou united. For in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they dig down a wall. So, he's saying, even though they dwell together, you see, they have more than weapons. You know, it's talking about the spiritual powers that they had. Because, you know, the Levites or the Haitians, that live in Haiti, they were the priests of the Most High. Predominantly, but we scattered all over because the actual Levites were scattered among all the tribes. But predominantly right there in Haiti. They know who they have there, you know. But they have spiritual power. They could take, like voodoo and all the things they call like that on the left side. They could take your sweat and perform voodoo and so forth. You know, they bury a shoe. They do all kind of madness like that, you know. They have spiritual power or they witchcraft, you know. You know, the Haitians on the top of the list of the voodoo. That's why the Most High said, don't let them be united. Let them be scattered among the tribes. Them Haitians, they couldn't be united. They had to be scattered among the tribes. That's why, you know, they didn't have a land. The Most High gave them, you know, the ability to be amongst all the tribes to perform the priestly duties. He said, don't let them be united. Let them be scattered among the tribes. Too much power. And say, cursed be their anger, for it was fierce. And their wrath, for it was cruel. Say, I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. That's why they couldn't be together. They could not be together. See. Look at Genesis 34. And 25. Genesis 34 and 25. Just showing you what he's reminiscing on and about. This is 34:25. And it came to pass on the third day when they were sore, because you know they had this Hamite raped our sister Dinah. And so Simeon and Levi said, hey, let them be circumcised, because they wanted to be part of the family and so forth. So they said, let them be circumcised. Let their children be circumcised. So on the third day, this is what we're reading about now. Now the men been circumcised, so they could be a part of us. This is what happened. And it came to pass on the third day, when they were sore, because they had been circumcised, that two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dominicans and the Haitians, Dinah's brethren, took each man his sword and came upon the city boldly and slew all the males. They killed all the males. And they slew Hamor and Shechem, his son. That was the father and the son. Shechem was the one that lay with Dinah with the edge of the sword, and took Dinah out of Shechem's house and went out. See, that's what he did. That's what our forefather Israel is talking about concerning them. See, Shechem, he raped our sister Dinah. And see, look at Genesis 34:1. And Dinah, the daughter of Leah, which she bare to Jacob, went out to see the daughters of the land. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the one we just read about who they killed, prince of the country, saw her, he took her and lay with her and defiled her. You hear that? He took her and lay with her and defiled her. And his soul clave unto Dinah, the daughter of Jacob. And he loved the damsel and spake kindly unto the damsel. Shechem spake unto his father Hamor, saying, get me this damsel to wife. He wanted to marry her. But you see what he did in verse 2. He saw her, he took her and lay with her and defiled her. See? Because we weren't supposed to be dealing with these other nations. Messiah told us this, reminded us, I'll say, in Deuteronomy 7:3, where it say defiled her. Neither shall thou make marriages with them. Thy daughter thou shalt not give unto his son, nor his daughter shalt thou take unto thy son. For they will turn away thy son from following me, that they may serve other gods, other idols. Because remember, Psalms 96:5 says, for all the gods of the nations are idols. So will the anger of the Most High be kindled against you and destroy thee suddenly. See? So this was Simeon and Levi did. Genesis 8. It says, Judah, thou art he whom thy brothers shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. So we looking at Judah. You see? Telling us that Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. When you look at Judah, who will be the so-called Negroes, though it's not pretty much want to be publicized as such, but Judah is the head tribe, and Judah's the main ones that's bringing forth the truth, so that everybody else is learning this truth from who? Judah, mainly, until this day. And Judah's the head tribe. And you can see this when you look at Revelations 7 and 4. The 144,000 are going to be the ruling party with the Mashiach Yahushua. You'll see that it starts with Judah. Of the 144,000, 12,000 of each of the tribes of Israel. In Revelations 7 and 4. And I heard the number of them which were sealed. And there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. See here? Of the tribe of Judah were sealed 12,000. See? So, Judah, it says the lawgiver. And when you look at with a Mashiach Yahushua, Hebrews 7:14. And we're going to get into a Mashiach Yahushua even within speaking of the tribes of Judah in these passages. Hebrews 7:14. For it is evident, it's a fact, that our power sprang out of Judah. A Mashiach Yahushua came out of the tribe of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. See? But a Mashiach Yahushua came out of the tribe of Judah. And he is our priest. He is our high priest. At this time. See? So going back to Judah. Genesis 49:8. Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. You see, in the political realm, who's all in the political realm? Mainly. All the way from the time that the Europeans came here to right now. Is Judah. All up in the political arena, in the neck of their enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Meaning they shall be the head tribe. Verse 9. Bear with me. Verse 9, Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down. He crouches as a lion, as an old lion. Who shall rouse him up? See, Judah's like a young lion. The prey is establishing this truth, bringing forth this truth. The laws of the Most High, and the understanding of this Bible, and the understanding of the Most High of the Mashiach Yahushua, along with the faith in the Mashiach Yahushua. But they're going after drugs, killing each other, getting ready to attack. That's what a lion, whenever a lion stooping down, is getting ready to attack. But I mean, you've been crouching for a long time, but ain't made a move. Since Martin Luther King, you see, way back in the 60s, been crouching for a long time, but ain't made a move because he's like an old lion. I mean, he's going in the wrong direction. Politics, sports, religions. Following the philosophies and the lies of this world, You know, I say, oh, you can't put new wine in old bottles. He's a young lion, but he's like an old lion. Crouching down, but ain't made a move for nothing. So I said, who gonna rouse us up? Most High. We'll rise them up. See? Judah's supposed to be teaching the tribes, which they are. But the Most High is gonna rise us up. See, when you understand Hosea 5 and 15. See, we move the Most High to anger by not keeping his law, statutes, commandments, his rules and regulations. This is what he said. I will go and return to my place till they acknowledge their offense, till we acknowledge how we have offended him and seek my face. Only way you're going to seek his face is to come back to him with humility and broken contrite spirit and follow his laws, statutes, commandments. Be obedient to him. This is what he's saying. In their affliction, they will seek me early. So in our affliction, as we being afflicted, have been afflicted, we're going to seek him early. If you want to come out of this. Because the Most High turned his back on us. See? But see, the Most High, he still have never forsaken the righteous. So those that come back to him in righteousness will be redeemed from this wicked world. You see? He's going to rouse us up. Because it's going to come a time when the prophecies of this Bible are going to be fulfilled. And Judah going to be in the spirit of it. When you look at Isaiah 48 and 1. Isaiah 48 and 1. Hear ye this, O house of Jacob, which are called by the name of Israel. We all are called by the name of Israel, our forefather. We're the Israelites, all 12 tribes, and are come forth out of the waters of Judah. See? All 12 tribes came out of the waters of Judah, which swear by the name of the Most High, and make mention of the Most High power of Israel, but not in truth, as it is today. We ain't under the law, they say. Ain't that what they teach you in the church? The truth is the law. Psalms 119, 142. Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth. That's why he said, but not in truth, nor in righteousness. So you can't be righteous if you're not doing what the Most High say. It's not going to work. So all 12 tribes come from the waters of Judah. Masechav Shai just said, we just read that in Hebrews 7:14, for this evidence of fact that our power sprang out of Judah. So the waters represent the lineage of Judah. How the Most High does it? His ways and thoughts are not our ways and thoughts, but that's what it says. And that's what we got to go by, the word of the Most High. Because I know the tribes, they don't, you know, it tells you how there will be problem with Judah because he's the head tribe. But it is what it is. I mean, we can't change it. It is written. So if it said Simeon, Levi, Issachar, whatever tribe it said, we got to go by it. At least that's how I feel. If not, then you got to take it over to Most High. That's all I can tell you. He can help you get through whatever it is that you're dealing with. But we got to eat the whole roll. We got to eat the whole thing. That's what it says. That's what we're going to do. And those that don't want to, write your own Bible. Come up with your own way. That's all I can tell you, because it is what it is. I mean, a lot of people, and it tells you how there would be, you know, thing with the northern tribes and southern tribes and all that, you know, because they called the whole Judah, Benjamin, Levi, they call them Judah, you know, from the southern tribes. And everybody went to Jerusalem, where Judah was at, in Judah, to honor the Most High and have the Holy Convocation until Jeroboam told them they wasn't going no more. He made two calves and said, this is who brought us out of Egypt. So therefore, the Most High took them into captivity under the Assyrians, the northern tribes. So they was under them, away from Israel, you know, the land of Israel in captivity. So going back to Genesis 49, and it has to make sense because Kamashak Abishai came out of the tribe of Judah. Genesis 49 and 10. The scepter, well, let's see. It said, who shall rouse him up? Who's going to rouse Judah up? You see. Let's look at what the Most High said in look at go to Ezekiel. Ezekiel 11 and 16. Say, therefore say, thus said the Most High Power, although I have cast them far off among the heathen, and although I have scattered them among the countries, yet will I be to them as a little sanctuary in the countries where they have come. And that's what the Most High has done. That's why when people look at these mega churches, he didn't really make us to have mega churches like you see these Christians and these different denominations that they are created in this world through religions, which come from a Latin word religio, which means to hold back, keep down, restrain. He said, he rising us up in little sanctuaries. Yet will I be to them as a little sanctuary in the countries where they shall come. See? Therefore say, thus say the Most High Power of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I will even gather you from the people and assemble you out of the countries where ye have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel. See, he's going to rise us up to fulfill this. And they shall come thither, and they shall take away all the detestable things thereof and all the abominations thereof from thence. And I will give them one heart, one mind, and I will put a new spirit within you. And I will take the stony heart out of their flesh and will give them an heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep mine ordinances and do them. And they shall be my people, and I will be their power. But as for them whose heart walketh after the heart of their detestable things and their abominations, all these religions and things that you're dealing with that's contrary to the laws that's come up to the Most High, I will recompense their way upon their own heads, said the Most High Power. See? So, he's going to rise us up. And we're going to go into the land of Zion. And we go, as it tells us in the Apocrypha, in 2nd Ezra. Go to 2nd Ezra, second chapter and verse 42. We'll start at 40. Second Ezra 2:40. Take thy number, O Zion, and shut up those of thine that are clothed in white, which have fulfilled the law of the Most High. Hear that? Those that are clothed in white, they have fulfilled the law of the Most High. This is the kingdom. The number of thy children whom thou long for is fulfilled. Beseech the power of the Most High that thy people, which have been called from the beginning, may be hallowed. I, Ezra, saw upon the Mount Zion a great people whom I could not number, and they all praised the Most High with songs. And in the midst of them, there was a young man of a high stature, taller than all the rest. And upon every one of their heads, he set crowns and was more exalted, which I marveled at greatly. So, this is Mashiach El Shai, bringing us to the kingdom and anointing the 144,000, 12,000 each of the tribes of Israel. And we're taller than everybody. And we're gonna praise the Most High of Mashiach El Shai with songs, it says. So let's continue on verse 10 of Genesis 49. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. That means the powers and authority. The scepter means the powers and authority shall not depart from Judah, it's saying. Nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. So, let you know, this is concerning the Mashiach El Shai. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. Like we said, Mashiach El Shai came from the tribe of Judah. Nor a lawgiver from between his feet, bringing the law. That's why he's going to beat these nations down with a rod of iron, which is the law. As you see, and he's going to rise us up. He's going to be more exalted. To be more exalted, he had to be exalted before the 144,000 go into the kingdom. Besides just saying his name, he got it because the Most High, look. That's why it all go together when you look at Philippians, the second chapter. And verse 9. Wherefore, the Most High also have highly exalted him. Talk about a Mashiach El Shai. And given him a name which is above every name. That the name of a Mashiach El Shai, every knee should bow, of things in heaven, of things in earth, and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that a Mashiach El Shai is the power, to the glory of the power and the Father, Yahweh. So, the Most High has highly exalted him, giving him a name above every name in heaven and earth and under the earth. That's why I say the scepter shall not depart from Judah in Genesis 49 and 10. So Mashiach El Shai came out of the tribe of Judah. Nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, who was the Mashiach El Shai, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. So we're supposed to be gathering ourselves to a Mashiach El Shai. Look. I mean, it's all here. It's just a matter of knowing how it all fits together. John 12:32. He said, and if I be lifted up from the earth, and he was, will draw all men unto me. He rose on the third day. In Acts 1:9, he said, and if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Acts 1:9. And when they had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfast toward heaven up in the sky, as he went up, see, and if I be lifted up from the earth, as he went up, he was lifted up from the earth. Behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, these two angels, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up in heaven, into heaven? The same of Mashiach Yahushua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. You're going to come the same way. As you see him go up into heaven, you're going to come down. He's going to descend from heaven. So when you see here, when it says, and while they looked in verse 10, steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by him in white apparel. So those are two angels. So what happened from there? Daniel seen a vision, had a vision concerning the Mashiach Yahushua. He seen him. In Daniel 7 and 13. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds. Now we can identify these clouds in Psalms 104 and 3. Because he says, he ascended up in the cloud after he had died, rose on the third day, walked the earth for 40 days. He ascended up in a cloud. So what are these clouds? Let's define them. In Psalms 104 and 3. Who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters, who maketh the clouds his chariots. So the clouds are vehicles, chariots. So now, we've seen in Acts, the first chapter, 10th verse, that the Mashiach of Shai ascended up in a cloud. So what happened when he ascended up in his cloud? It tells you what happened. Daniel sinned. What happened when he did ascend in a vision? Daniel 7 and 13. I saw in the night visions. See? And behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. This is a Mashiach Yahushua. And came to the Ancient of Days, who was the Most High. And they brought him near before him. They brought him to the Ancient of Days. I mean, ancient nobody lived longer than the Most High. That's the Ancient of Days. That's right. Look at Job 36:26. Behold, the Most High is great, and we know him not, neither can the number of his years be searched out. That's Ancient of Days. So the number of his years cannot be searched out. So let you know, this is the Most High, who the angels brought in the chariots of the Most High. We call them IFOs, identified flying objects, before the Most High. In Daniel 7:13, verse 14 of Daniel's 7th chapter. And there was given him dominion. This is given to a Mashiach Yahushua, dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, that which shall not be destroyed. That's our power. So that's the scepter, the powers and authority that has been given him. And you can also look at what he said, and we're looking at this power that's been given him, Mashiach Yahushua, who's of the tribe of Judah. And John 5:22. For the Father judges no man, but have committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which hath sent him. See? So the Most High is giving all the judgment unto a Mashiach Yahushua. That's why when you read 2 Corinthians 5 and 10, it says, for we must all appear, 2 Corinthians 5 and 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of a Mashiach Yahushua. That ain't a subject. That ain't rulership. That's power right there. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of a Mashiach Yahushua, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he have done, whether it be good or bad. See, we all going to meet the judgment seat of a Mashiach Yahushua and going to be judged in the things that we have done in these mortal bodies, whether it was good or bad. And if what's good and bad is what's judged upon what the Most High has given us in his rules and regulations, his laws, such commandments, in keeping them. Say, knowing therefore the terror of, do that sound the love of? No, it says right here in the New Testament, the terror of the Most High. We persuade men, but we are made manifest unto the Most High, and I trust also are made manifest in your consciences, in your minds, where you think, if you're going to think right, you see? So, and his judgment is going to be true, because he said in John 10 and 30, I and my Father are one. They agree. So his judgment is going to be according to the judgment of the Most High. He's going to bring it forth. Look at Revelation 5 and 5. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, of Mashiach Yahushua, have prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. So Mashiach Yahushua, he says, be given authority from the Most High to fulfill the will of the Most High. But you got to understand. Going back to Genesis 49, verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. See, Judah is in charge of bringing these laws through the 12 tribes. And until Shiloh come, you know, that means peaceable, which is a Mashiach Yahushua.